Welcome to Lecture 1 of Psychology Intro. Psychology has four basic goals. We have to first describe behavior and describe in a way that's scientific as well as statistically reliable. We describe behavior as individuals all the time, but that's our individual experience and not necessarily a scientific description of what happens for lots of different people. Once we've got a good description of the behavior, we have to then explain it to figure out why there's a behavior that's happening and why people act a certain way in a certain situation. If we do a good job of explaining the behavior, then we will be able to predict when that behavior is likely to happen again. And we can use our statistical methods to say that there is a good chance the behavior will happen under a certain set of circumstances, if our model of the behavior is good. And then finally, the most difficult part of psychology is controlling or changing behavior. It's sort of like the idea that if we can understand why people act the way they do, we can also work with people who are acting in ways that are not particularly good and help them change their behavior so they can be better. So psychology, for example, could do research into tattoos and ask, why would someone get an armpit tattoo, as in this picture here? And then why would they have the need to like share that with the rest of the world? We could explain why. We could then predict under what circumstances people are likely to get tattoos. And then if we decide that tattooing your armpit is dumb, we could control or change that behavior. Psychology's roots begin in religion and philosophy. Both religion and philosophy describe human behavior, but they also go a step further and recommend ideal behavior, such as the religious idea of, you know, treating other people like you want to be treated, or philosophy addressing questions of what is ethical, what is right, what is wrong. Neither of them are as scientific as psychology, so psychology tends to go more toward the science side of things, whereas religion and philosophy are asking questions about what is the ideal life, what is the good life, what is the best life, the best way to live and act and be. Some key debates in religion and philosophy that occurred before psychology became professional and scientific concern the nature of humans. Like, for example, are humans blank when they're born and then they get sort of written on by their experience? You might have learned this in world studies as John Locke and tabula rasa. Or are humans pre-encoded with behavior, which you might have learned in biology as Mendelian genetics, DNA encoding certain kinds of characteristics and behaviors. Other questions that were asked were things like, is the mind separate from the body? Does the mind continue to exist after the body stops existing? So here are some of the key figures here. Religions like Confucianism, which is more of a philosophy, Buddhism, the Hebrew scriptures, Christianity, Islam, the Greek philosophers like Plato, Aristotle, people like René Descartes, John Locke. All of these are famous faces in the questions about humans' existence before psychology becomes scientific. The first psychologist that we can say is absolutely a scientifically minded psychologist is Wilhelm Wundt, one of the founders of structuralism. He created a laboratory of psychology at the University of Leipzig in 1879. And he and one of his students, Titchener, believed that psychology could describe human consciousness. He was very interested in people's thoughts, their experience of thought. And he said it could be broken down into basic structures. So you have parts and pieces of thought that added together create your consciousness. So psychologists call his ideas structuralism. Their chief method for investigating structuralism was called introspection, in which you simply ask someone to describe what they're thinking, to narrate what they are consciously thinking about at any particular moment in time. So you might, for example, sit them in a lab and hand them a flower and talk through what they think about when they look at this flower. And then you could sort of add up all of those structures and decide what their conscious thought was. An American psychologist rejected structuralism. This psychologist was William James, who was more interested in the way in which our consciousness keeps us alive. He said the structure is not as important as the way in which our conscious thought helps us navigate the world, helps us survive, helps us be able to react and adapt to the world around us. So we call his methodology functionalism, because it focuses on the way that our consciousness functions, not its parts, but the way it works. And then came Gestalt. Max Wertheimer, Wolfgang Kohler, Kurt Kafka, a lot of German psychologists basically said, you know, the focus on parts and pieces of consciousness makes no sense. We have to study all of consciousness, that the whole is really much, much greater than the parts are. The Gestaltists basically said we see the world in a more complex way than just pieces of experience, that somehow the pieces get added together and stitched together in our brains to be more complicated than just parts. Currently, we have about 7 perspectives on psychology that we use on a day-to-day basis to try to understand people's behavior. The first is psychodynamic or psychoanalytic. This is associated with Sigmund Freud. The idea that Freud advanced in psychology was that not everything people do is conscious. Sometimes people behave in ways that are unconscious. There are thoughts, impulses, and desires going on in our brains that we aren't aware of and don't know why we act the way we act. Freud said that these unconscious impulses and desires motivate us to do things, and then we are left kind of wondering, why did we do that? So you will see this sometimes called psychoanalytic theory. For our purposes, psychodynamic, psychoanalytic are the same thing. About the 1920s or so, there was a group of psychologists who got really tired of focusing on unconscious behavior, conscious behavior, what's going on in the brain, and we call them behaviorists. James Watson is the first major behaviorist, and he's followed by B.F. Skinner. The behaviorists focused entirely on what they could see, actions that are learned, observable, and measurable. They said that the mind is a black box. You cannot scientifically study what's going on in the mind, so it's not even worth paying attention to. Conscious thought, who can see that? You can't. You can't see that at work. All that we can see is what people choose to do, how they choose to behave, how they choose to act. So basically, the behaviorists are interested in actions, not thoughts. They also basically end up arguing that human behavior is the product of its environment. And this is, makes sense. If you focus on people's actions and only what you can see, and you downplay thoughts, you're going to end up assuming that, in essence, people learn what happens and how to act by the world around them. They are nurtured into behavior. We are simply just little machines responding to things that go on around us. By about the 60s, psychology was basically split into two camps, the Freudian side and the behaviorist side, and they weren't playing pretty nicely with each other. But another group of psychologists started to ask questions that were kind of like the Gestaltists. They were starting to think about human behavior as something more than just the sum of its parts, or something more than just the response to the environment around you. And people like Abraham Maslow and Carl Rogers invent humanistic psychology. The humanists, influenced by a lot of what was going on in the 1960s, talked about how humans have free will. We have the power to choose who we want to be. We can live creative, we can live meaningful, satisfying lives. We are people. We're not just like parts, acting on unconscious impulses, responding to our environment. We have the power to choose. And so this humanistic psychology really challenges these assumptions of the behaviorists as well as the Freudians, that people just simply do things without knowing why or because their environment tells them to. We have the power to make choices. By about the 1950s, another field of psychology was rising by Ulrich Neisser and other figures in the field who said the brain actually is worth studying. These are the cognitive psychologists, and they study things like memory, they studied language usage, problem solving. They were interested in what's going on in the brain, even though we can't observe the brain directly. The cognitive psychologists basically said that there are brain processes, there are steps that happen, and those steps that occur in the brain do influence how we behave. There are things that are going on inside our skulls that explain what we do and how we do it. By about the 50s and 60s, there was another field as well, the biological psychologists, and they come at psychology more from a medical science perspective. They're interested in all of the biology that's going on that makes us who we are. And when I say biology, I don't mean just brain parts and what's the functions of those brain parts, but also the genetic programming that sets up who we are as people. Part of what the biological psychologists do is talk about ways in which the structures of our bodies and our genetics promote our survival. So why does a particular part of the brain act the way it acts? Well, it's because that helped us survive and then pass on our genes to our children. So in many ways, the biological psychologists end up being the opposite of the behaviorists. They talk about how our nature, our interior design, helps shape who we are. You know, we're just bundles of cells with a whole bunch of electrochemical activity. And that is sort of making up us as people. And we have no conscious power to change that programming very much, because it's already hardwired into who we are. Finally, there's a group of people who say, all of this we've talked about so far is great and wonderful until you realize that human beings don't live alone. People live with other people. And so a lot of our behavior is shaped by our interactions with the world around us. We live in cultures. Our cultures have beliefs. Our cultures teach us ways to behave. And so those cultural sort of interactions do shape behavior as well. So sociocultural psychology doesn't look at psychology as a study of individuals. It looks at it as a study as of people in interaction with other people, where our culture tells us what is acceptable, what to believe, how to act, what's cool, what's appropriate, why certain things are okay to do and other things are not okay to do. Now you might think, oh gosh, we got 7 approaches to psychology. Do I have to pick one? Do I just like stick with one side or another? Do I pick 2? What is like sort of like a menu of choices? And honestly, you don't have to pick. Each one of these approaches offers something different that is useful. You know, humanism, psychodynamic, biopsychology, cognitive, all tell us how behavior originates inside of us, either by a free will choice, unconscious desire, electrochemical activity, or brain processes. Behavioral and cultural psychology tell us how behavior originates outside of us, through our environment or the culture in which we live. And it's not like it's one or the other. It's all of these. These 7 approaches also help us think about how much control we have over our behavior. You know, the humanists and the cognitive folks really emphasize our ability to directly control our behavior. It's our choice. And a lot of the behavior that's out of our control, we see coming out of biopsych or cultural, we learn it, or psychodynamic, it's unconscious. So these 7 approaches are not all sort of to be taken as you pick one or the other or 2, because they all have ways in which we can work together to understand human behavior and all of its complexity. So, psychologists like an eclectic or an integrated approach to these perspectives. Don't pick one, you pick all, and you use the one that seems to make the most sense in any given situation. You can get a more complete picture of behavior by combining the perspectives rather than picking one over the other. For example, let's say you have a friend who has anxiety. And you're trying to figure out why that person has anxiety. Well, biopsych says that it's a change in brain chemistry. Okay, that might be true, but is that true for your friend? Is it a learned behavior? Perhaps your friend learned anxiety because a parent modeled anxiety to them as a kid or put them in an environment that was anxious. So maybe it was an adaptive response to the world around them. Maybe they lived in anxious, provoking circumstances where home life was not all that great, and they learned to be anxious in order to deal with it. Perhaps it was a product of unresolved feelings. Maybe deep down, unconsciously, something has happened to them and they've never really dealt with it, and their anxiety is an outgrowth of these unconscious motivations and drives. Or maybe this anxiety is in a sort of deep-seated dissatisfaction with your identity as a person. And maybe you need to make a choice. You need to exercise your free will to become a better, more complete, more whole, authentic you by recognizing what you don't like about yourself and then changing that. So keep in mind, you don't have to pick one approach or another. Something as simple as having anxiety might require you using all the approaches or the best two, whichever ones are most likely to explain that behavior. Now, this last section of the PowerPoint takes us into the question of what we can do with psychology today. So, if you want to go on in psychology and treat people with therapy, that is, talking through their problems, you will need a degree in clinical psychology, a PhD. If you take that degree and you spend it most of the time in research, teaching at the college level, you certainly can do that and be more of a research psychologist, design experiments, teach psychology classes, train psych majors, that sort of thing. You don't have to counsel, but you could. So for example, my first psych teacher was both a practicing counselor, a psychiatrist or a psychologist, as well as a teacher and a researcher. Sometimes people want to take the counseling direction, but work with students. And so you might end up being a school psychologist. Lots of school psychologists do have PhDs. Some of them have master's degrees, depending on where you are and what requirements you have to fill to be licensed. And so you might work with students, usually on like intelligence testing kinds of issues or difficult learning disabilities, for example. If you want to treat people and be able to prescribe them medicine, you will need to be a psychiatrist, which is basically you have to become a medical doctor. Psychiatrists need a lot more knowledge about the way in which the body works biologically and how medicines interact with the body to treat people's illnesses. This chart shows what people do typically today with their psych degrees. So about 48% of folks go into clinical with the PhD, counseling 8.3. You can do social psychology and even social work with a psych degree. Some people do the biological side, and they often combine it with the neuroscience side because it's a hot new field. Some people go into working for corporations, and so they do industrial organizational psychology, which is where you help train companies in managing their human resources. You deal with job conflicts, you deal with personality issues, those sorts of things. Some people do developmental psych, which is how children grow and develop over time. Educational psychology, so training people how to learn, how to teach. Cognitive is not a particularly large field, and then all the other falls into a fairly large category. I hate when people do this. They put everything in other and it ends up being bigger than everything else. Then you're like, what does that other include? Most psychologists work somewhere in human services, doing some kind of help through counseling, human resources to help people. The next biggest group of them teach in colleges and universities, and they might still practice, but they probably also either teach courses or conduct their own research. Some focus their work in think tanks or other organizations. They might purely work on research. And then another 21% do government work. For example, the military. There's a lot of psychology there involved in how do you interrogate people, how do you interrogate criminals, how do you do psychology ops missions, for example.